Welcome back to the last part of the first tutorial. In this part, we're going to be discussing how to find the stability of fixed points that we defined in the previous part of the tutorial. So the phase plane allows us to visualize the dynamics of change of the population activity R as a function of time. As a function of the activity of this neural population itself, R. So rather than plotting R versus T, seeing how the activity changes in time, here we are plotting the change in R as a function of T, as a function of the population R, namely dr dt as a function of R. Because the FI curve F is nonlinear, this dr dt function goes up and down several times, as we can see on this plot here. So there's a few kinks in different parts of this curve. We define the concept now of flow in this phase plane that tells us whether the dynamics will increase or decrease in time. To do this, we had to calculate whether the derivative, so the change in the activity versus time, was positive or negative. So in regions of this phase plane where the derivative was positive, where dr dt was bigger than zero, the flow of the dynamics was to the right, meaning that the population activity R will increase in time, and vice versa, in regions where this derivative dr dt was negative, the flow was to the left, meaning that the population activity R will decrease in time. We also define the fixed points of the dynamics by setting the derivative dr dt equal to zero. So we got this entire expression of the right-hand side. And so indeed, graphically, to visualize where these fixed points are, we literally just had to see where this curve intersected the dashed line, which indicates zero. So the fixed points here correspond to these gray circles, where exactly the zero crossings are of this function. Okay, so now we're interested in determining the stability of these fixed points. A very easy way to visualize graphically where the fixed points are is to simply look at the direction of flow of the activity in this phase plane. So we have now denoted the arrows, and we can simply define the stable and the unstable fixed points to be such that a stable fixed point is one where the arrows, where the flow points towards the fixed point. So this is the case for this lower and also for this highest fixed point. And if the arrows point away from the fixed point, meaning that the flow pushes activity far away from the fixed point, then graphically we can determine that that fixed point is unstable. So here we have indicated this unstable fixed point with the empty circle. However, we can also determine the stability of these fixed points in a mathematical or an algebraic way by actually looking at the equations for how a small perturbation of the activity around each fixed point will evolve in time. So in order to do this, we have to look at how this perturbation will behave locally around the fixed point. So by linearizing the dynamics of the activity of the population around each of the fixed points. So we effectively have to consider the tangents of this curve, and which are indicated here with the gray lines, and we have to see whether then this local perturbation will be amplified, in which case the activity will go away from the fixed point, or it will decay to zero, in which case the activity will converge back to the fixed point, which is indicative of a stable fixed point. So the question is, how do such small perturbations of the activity around each of the fixed points behave? Namely, do they grow or do they decay in time? So to do this, let's look at the original equation. So we had an equation for the activity, dr dt, as a function of time. And let's consider a particular fixed point of this dynamics, which we denote with r star. Because r star is a fixed point, by definition, the derivative at r star is actually equal to zero. So now we can write an equation where dr star dt is equal to zero. Now we consider a small perturbation around the fixed point. the perturbation is of size epsilon. So now the new activity is given by R equal to R star plus epsilon. We want to see what happens to epsilon in time. So to do this, we plug in this expression for R in the main equation for dr dt that we had on the previous slide. If we do this, because we know that R can be written as the sum of R star and epsilon, we can decompose each of the terms, each of the places where R occurs in the equation by replacing it with the sum of R star plus epsilon. Then we can apply a second algebraic trick. Because R star is a fixed point and we know that dr star dt is equal to zero, we can eliminate certain terms of that equation. So in the end, we're left with just an expression for how the perturbation epsilon changes in time. So just a differential equation for epsilon as a function of time. Another trick that we have applied that I have not indicated in this slide is that because we're doing a linear approximation of how this perturbation evolves around the fixed point, so we're basically doing a linearization, we're also ignoring any high order effects, so any high order terms such as epsilon squared, epsilon cubed, and so on that could occur, that would occur in this expression. So we only consider terms that have epsilon to first order. So then we get this first order differential equation for epsilon that will tell us how the dynamics now of the perturbation will behave. We can slightly rewrite the expression by taking epsilon from inside the brackets. So here it occurs in these two places. We can take it outside, namely here. And so now the expression in the bracket is completely independent of epsilon. So you probably recognize this as a simple first order differential equation that we can solve analytically. And you probably remember that, in fact, the solution of such a differential equation is just an exponential, which has an exponent lambda. So the way epsilon will behave in time is just exponential e to the lambda t. And the exponent lambda has the following expression. So it's an exponent that depends on the properties of the network itself, namely the connectivity parameter w as well as the external input. And it also obviously depends on which fixed points we're studying, because we want to determine whether this particular fixed point is stable or not. So as you might expect, because the solution is an exponential, to determine whether this perturbation will decay or grow in time, we have to determine the sign of the exponent lambda. So let's again write this expression for lambda on the next slide. It's important to state that this lambda, this exponent lambda, is called the eigenvalue of the dynamical system. So here, because we study a one-dimensional dynamical system, because we have a single population of neurons whose dynamics we're studying, a lambda is just a single number, but this concept of eigenvalue to determine stability of fixed points also pertains to the second tutorial where we study a two-dimensional dynamical system, because we investigate networks with two populations of excitatory and inhibitory neurons. Okay, but let's return to our case of a one-dimensional dynamical system, and let's investigate whether, under which conditions, this lambda becomes is positive or negative, which basically determines whether the fixed point will be stable or unstable. So we consider two cases. The first case is when lambda is negative. So then the solution is just an exponential with a negative exponent, which, as you know, decays in time. So this means that the perturbation will completely decay in time, meaning that the activity around which was the fixed point that was perturbed will actually converge just to the fixed point. So this determines that the fixed point is stable. So this is the case indeed for the two fixed points that we identified as stable using the graphical analysis, namely the one with the low and the one with the high value. On the other hand, if this exponent is positive, that means that the perturbation will grow in time, because now the solution for the perturbation epsilon will be an exponential with a positive exponent that will obviously blow up. So this means that the activity will grow farther and farther away from the fixed point, and therefore the fixed point is defined to be unstable. So this is the case for the fixed point of this intermediate value that we determined earlier in the graphical way. And we will end this tutorial by again returning to the other way to visualize the activity of the population, not in the phase plane where we showed DRDT versus R, but in the more traditional way, namely to visualize how the activity changes in time. We already saw this in the last tutorial, but effectively, depending on where we start in the phase plane, what value of the activity of the neural population we start with, in this case indicated here by the two arrows, the red versus the blue, we can plot that as well in the activity versus time plane. So these are the two fixed points, these are the two initial conditions, one indicated with the red, one indicated with the blue arrow, namely 0.2 and 0.6. And we see that they each converge to one of the two stable fixed points that are determined in the phase plane. So the red one goes to the lower fixed point and the blue initial condition goes to the upper fixed point. This is not just the case for these two initial conditions that we have chosen. Basically, any set of initial conditions that you choose that are located between these two fixed points, so between the stable and the unstable one, will converge to the lower stable fixed point. So here we show several such examples. And vice versa, if we choose multiple initial conditions for the population R that are between the unstable and the higher stable fixed point, they will converge to the upper stable fixed point. And so we indicate this here with the multiple trajectories in black. So indeed, all the trajectories are attracted to the two stable fixed points and away from the unstable fixed point. Okay, so what we have covered in today's tutorial has been two ways in which we can determine the stability of the fixed points. One, a graphical way, which really helps us determine the stability simply by looking at the direction of flow of the vector field in the phase plane. Fixed points are stable if the trajectory flows towards them, and if they flow out of them, then the fixed points are unstable. We also derived an analytical way that allowed us to effectively perturb the activity around a fixed point and derive, using linearization techniques, a differential equation that told us whether the perturbation will grow or decay in time. In the tutorial, we will now explore how to do this numerically. So what you will do is you will find the fixed points and you will determine their stability both graphically and algebraically. If there is time, you can also simulate a more interesting biological scenario where the external input is not just static, but is also noisy and random.